Over the last 2 weeks, we've been looking at eschatology. And that was a great note at the time. And hopefully it'll be up there shortly. You got it plugged in, mate. This is what happened last week, Georgina, with yours, and what it is, because we took the USB out, it didn't work, and Andrew assured me today it was going to work without the USB, but it did for a little while, but not now, so we should be right. There it is, eschatology. It means the study of the end times, and this week we're going to look at the Great Tribulation. We looked last week at Mark chapter 13, and we looked at the events that Jesus was talking about that were happening at the end times, and we were able to examine and see that some of these things are still yet to happen, some have happened and some are always happening. And one of the things that we looked at was that there was going to be a great tribulation, and Jesus said to them, pray that it doesn't happen in winter, because it's going to be the worst thing you've ever experienced, and pray that you don't go through it, and also be relaxed, because for the sake of the elect, for the sake of the chosen ones, for the sake of those whose names are written in the book of life, those days will be shortened. Now, it is often said that churches do not talk about the end times very much. Now, I don't agree with that. I think that the churches actually talk about the end times basically all the time, but 9 times out of 10 we don't realise it. How many people here know the Lord's Prayer? It's pretty good. Who's going to volunteer just to say it? Good on you, Georgina. Right, hold it there. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name, yes. Thy kingdom come. So we're asking that his kingdom come, where? On earth as it is in heaven. So we're talking about setting up a kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Okay, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy kingdom come. We're talking of the end times. Every time we say or think about the Lord's Prayer, we are talking and asking for the end times. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So this is a bit interesting. We sort of want that to happen now while we're living here, that it'd be God's rule. But we know, particularly today with all that's going on, that this isn't necessarily God's rule. It's Satan's rule. And you see it, and there was an interesting article written by a non-Christian in the Australian, Paul Kelly, a writer, and it was sent to me by email by Dinah. And he's talking about the fact that things are happening. There is no focus of where normality is. No focus of where righteousness is. It's, if it feels good, do it. If it's, consensus, yeah, well, you know, and no argument. No standing up for morality, as he put it. And the churches have lost their way in terms of not standing up. He was mainly commenting on the fact that there was, you know, in Australia in particular, religion so-called dying, not everywhere else in the world. And so it is, when we pray the Lord's Prayer, we're asking for his kingdom to come on earth. Let's have a look. One thing we know about the end times: for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. And we looked at that and last week as well, and Alan said to me afterwards. Look, things done in the body, does that could refer to the church, you know, Jesus' body, the church? And I said, yes, it could, but all scholars, based on context, based on where it is there, based on the words written, was referring to the body in which we dwell, our physical body. And when we asked this the week before, and Carolyn said, oh, what's this referring to? And she said, oh, we're going to be judged for the things we do, good or bad, whilst we're here on earth. And I said, no, it's in the body. Not on earth, it's in the body, what we've done in the body. Now, the interesting thing is, we perhaps don't get to see and realise and understand the importance of that verse and the importance of what we're being judged on in this body, because it talks about what's going to happen when we get to heaven. But more importantly, what we don't realise is that heaven is actually going to be on earth. And Jesus said in his own words, you know, heaven and earth may pass away, but my words will remain forever. And when we die, we think that we're going to go to some place up high in heaven where God is reigning, which is what heaven is, where God reigns, where God rules, where God is, where God loves. That's true. But do you realize that we're actually going to be here on earth again? You look at me all bewildered, but we'll have a look at what the Bible's got to say. Let's move on. And what it's talking about is the Great Tribulation. The Great Tribulation. What is it? Next. What is it? When is it? And what has it to do with me? What is the Great Tribulation? And when is it? We've learnt we don't know the hour of the season when the Lord comes again. So theoretically we don't know when the tribulation is going to be, the Great Tribulation. But we have been given some clues by Jesus, by God, as well as to the likely times. A bit like the story that was done for the children today. Needed to be prepared, be watchful, be expecting. Don't know exactly when it's going to happen, but by watching, you know it's going to happen and how close it's getting. And the advantage of that is so that we can rejoice. Not rejoice because the disasters are happening to us, but rejoice because thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, is getting closer and closer. So take heart. Do not be despondent by what you see going on around you. Next, what is it? What's the Great Tribulation? Well, the word tribulation refers to the distress, trouble, persecution, and suffering experienced by believers as a result of living faithfully in a world opposed to God. We Christians get, I don't know what the right word is, but we get tribulated all the time for what we do and believe and for what we stand. Margaret Court stood up and believed and said, marriage, you know, it's a biblical concept. Marriage is between a man and a woman. And so what does everybody else come out? They say, we want to take the name off the arena in which it's named after because she stood up and said this. If everybody's prepared to be forgiving and giving everybody a fair go, well, she's entitled to what she has to say. I happen to believe very strongly in what she has to say. But let's say she was wrong. So what? She's entitled to say it. But no, because she's saying what the Bible says, she gets kicked about it. We all do. When you're at school, and for some of us that was a long time ago, if you said, where were you going? Oh, I'm going to go to Boys Brigade or Girls Brigade or Sunday school, and you know, all that sort of stuff. You get mocked. How many of you, when you're in working, were prepared to stand up and say, I'm for Jesus? We would be a little bit frightened and hesitant because we get mocked or whatever. And so when the world encounters the truth of God in the gospel, it responds with tribulation and persecution for those who bear witness. So why do we get worried about that? That's the norm. If we happen to have a pleasant time about it, hallelujah. But be prepared and expect tribulation for standing up for the Lord. You must persevere. You must stand up for him. The Great Tribulation refers to an unprecedented event where there will be intense suffering that will characterize the time prior to Christ's return, just before he comes. It's going to be such a mess, such a horror, that to shorten the days, Jesus returns and collects us. The dead in Christ shall rise first, then the rest of us, as the Bible puts it. Next. The phrase Great Tribulation, Thlipsis Megasus, or Thlipsis Megas, mega, you know, mega center, mega shopping center, great. The Great Trouble only occurs four times in the New Testament. In Matthew 24:21, Acts 7:11, and Revelation 2:22 and 7:14. The only time the words Great Tribulation occur. Okay, four times only. Matthew, and it talks of, that's by Jesus, Acts and Revelation. Let's have a look at what they are about. Acts 7:11, I'm leaving the Matthew one to last because it's the biggest. Then a famine struck all Egypt and Canaan, bringing great suffering, and our fathers could not find food. What's he referring to there? When they were, you know, Joseph, back to those days, and the famine and all that, he said it was a great tribulation. And they had to go and live in Egypt. And for, you know, hundreds of years they lived in Egypt until the Exodus. That then was a great tribulation. Didn't just say tribulation, it was a great tribulation. And in Revelation 2:22, it talks about, so I'll cast her on a bed of suffering, and I'll make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely, great tribulation, unless they repent of her ways. This is about the followers of Jezebel and the punishment that's going to be afflicted upon them for following her, for losing their way and following the Jezebel. Okay, a great tribulation again. Not just an ordinary tribulation. Revelation 7:14, I answered, Sir, you know. And he said, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. This is John seeing in Revelation. And he said, who are all these people? And the angel replied, these are the people that have come out of the great tribulation. These are the people who have come, you know, this is the church, is what people believe it is. And then we have the words of Jesus in Matthew 24 verses 21 and so on. For then there will be great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world until now, and never to be equaled again. Now that's interesting. The great tribulation is unequaled from the beginning of the world until now, and never to be equaled again. Why would you add and never to be equaled again if it was just the one-off thing, looking to the future, and it won't happen again in the future? There is something there in theology, there's something there in understanding the Bible that we need to somehow hang our hat on. And as we go through, hopefully we'll find the answer to that. Next. Now when we look at the one in Acts, as I said, it describes a time of intense suffering caused by a famine during the time of the patriarchs. Okay, it was a sample. It was a pretty big distress, and for those in those days it would have been a calamity, because they didn't have their mobile phones, and they didn't have Aldi, and they didn't have everywhere else you could go and get your tucker. You know, they were actually living by what they grew, what they raised. And so to have such a huge famine was just terrible. We know that the famines in Ethiopia and all that are very similar to probably what happened then, but that was pretty bad. And in Revelation, Jesus warns the followers of Jezebel, the false prophetess who is promoting immorality and idolatry, sounds like what's starting to happen today, or been happening, that he will make them suffer intensely, that they will have great tribulation. And here the expression refers to Jesus' judgment on the unrepentant followers of a false teacher. Jesus says to them, even though you're following her, repent, but if you don't repent, this is what, you know, there will be great distress come upon you. However, the most important one, next, is about Matthew. And here it is at 24:21 occurs in the context of his Olivet discourse, you know, the Mount of Olives when he gave his talk and all that. And they say the context can be divided into four parts. Some scholars say it goes this way. Other scholars say, well, no, it's all lumped into one. Well, let's have a look. 4 to 14 describes the birth pains that will occur throughout the entire age of the church, e.g. wars, famines, earthquakes, persecution, apostasy, and false prophets. That's happening from when Jesus returned home until today. Everywhere you look, there are wars, there are famines, there are earthquakes, persecutions, apostasy, and false prophets. Okay? That's going to happen in our life. Some of it will be natural, some of it will be done as a spiritual thing. And then 25, the second part, 15 to 20, portrays the horrifying destruction of the Jerusalem temple in AD 70. Jesus took a specific event, talking to his specific followers at a specific time, to tell them this is what's going to happen, to remind them that his words were true. They got to see what he prophesied happen. But at the same time, in this one, he was talking about the future as well. Okay, so in order just to let them know what I'm telling you is fair dinkum, they got to see just a few years later exactly what he was talking about. Let's have a look next. And in Matthew 24:21 spells out the period known as the Great Distress that immediately precedes Jesus' return. And I don't have time to go through it here today. Probably what we've got to do is have a look at a Bible study whereby we go through these things verse by verse, word by word, and to see where it is if you want that knowledge. But let me tell you, it talks about a period of what it's going to be roughly like just prior to Jesus' return, and it's horrific. And that's where it talks about, you know, let's hope you're not childbearing. Let's hope you're not pregnant. Let's hope you're not having, it doesn't happen in winter. It is going to be catastrophic. And we can all get scared about that. We can all get worried about that. But the beauty of it is, if our book name is written in the book of life, we're protected. God's just going to protect us. And then Matthew 24:29 depicts the return of Christ, how he's going to come. You know, people will see, people will know, and he'll collect us all from the four corners of the earth and take us home. Okay? That's what that part is there. It talks about that great tribulation. We really don't know what is happening in the great tribulation. All we're told is if you've experienced something horrible, then multiply it by a million and you'll get an idea. Next. Some see all of Matthew as describing the great tribulation rather than dividing the unit into sections. They believe that Jesus interweaving prophecy throughout the whole lot that relate both to his generation and to the end times. I think both's right. I think what's been done there previously, how it does divide up into four, is correct, but I think Jesus was interweaving stuff there for his people at his time and for us in the future. Others see the entire period from AD 70, from after the destruction of the temple, to Jesus' return as the time of great distress. They're saying, well, it's not going to be a final catastrophic event. They're saying that catastrophic event has started and it's going to culminate in the kaboom. Well, that's all possible. But we don't need to get in and argue about whether it was this or it was that. What we need to get and argue about and understand is that these are the signs that Jesus is coming home and it's getting closer. Next. In summary, the great distress of Matthew refers to a period of intense tribulation and persecution at the end of the age just prior to Jesus' return. That's what we get out of it. Whether it started in AD 70 or whether it's to happen as a single event, who knows, who cares, it doesn't matter. What does matter is it's just before Jesus returns, there's going to be a time of intense persecution. And assuming Jesus, saying that believers will be present during that time, Jesus assures his disciples that those days will be shortened for the sake of the elect. So we've got to go through it. And it happens tomorrow. We can rest assured that those days will be shortened for our sake. Okay, that he's going to look after us. That he's in control. We just got to be saying, hallelujah, thy kingdom come. And he just appears to be using the near event of the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem as a forerunner to predict the truth. Next. Now, when is it? Well, the following of the sealing of the 144,000 in Revelation 7:1-8, John sees a great multitude that no one can count from every nation, tribe, people and language standing before the throne in front of the Lamb. They are wearing white robes, holding palm branches and crying out praises to God and the Lamb. The angels, elders and four living creatures join the great multitude in praising God. So what we're seeing is that the Great Tribulation, we don't know when it is, but we see what the result's going to be. And next, it tells us this. Then one of the elders says, John, these in white robes, who are they and where do they come from? And John says, I don't know. And the elder provides, these are they who have come out of the Great Tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Who are these people and what does it mean that they have come out of the Great Tribulation? So we know the Great Tribulation has happened, but there's a multitude that's come through it. Who are they? Who are they? Hopefully it's you. Hopefully it's me. Next, it tells us the immediate context demonstrates the entire episode refers to an event that has already occurred, and the washing their robes in white in Christ's blood likely refers to their perseverance through tribulation made possible by their reliance on the faithful witness to the atoning death of Christ, the blood of the Lamb. They are the ones who have been made whole, made beautiful, because of Jesus' death on the cross. They are believers who have faithfully persevered in times of terrible persecution and tribulation. So the moral and the message for us here is we're going to have trouble, we're going to have persecution, we must persevere, and we have our names written in the book of life, and we'll be there after the Great Tribulation, and that's the important thing, that we're there after the Great Tribulation. Next. And there's disagreement whether these people are to be identified as the church or whether they're martyrs, just martyrs or whatever. Who cares? Who knows? The reality is your name's got to be written in the book of life and you'll be there after the Great Tribulation, which is what counts. And finally, in Daniel, God's people are persecuted because of their covenant relationship with God, so that some even turn away from the faith. We're going to be so persecuted that some of us may turn away from faith. We are not to do that. No matter what happens, stand firm. It's easy to give up, but don't. Yet those who trust in the Lord, those whose name is found written in the book, will ultimately be delivered. Some will be delivered through resurrection and from the dead. Some of us will be delivered through the tribulation itself. Some will be brought up, those that have already died will be delivered as well. And next, I'll skip that. Let's go on to the next one. What we know is this. All Christians undergo tribulations, whether hardships in general life or as a result of following Jesus. And if you haven't experienced it, good. You had a great life. Tribulation is therefore a present day reality, and we are all called to persevere. We may or may not go through the Great Tribulation, but our response ought to be the same. Hope, joy, and perseverance on our part, knowing that God will ultimately conquer evil and deliver justice. That's our hope. We persevere because we know that God is going to deliver justice. We persevere because we know we are God's. We persevere because we have great hope, and we have joy because we understand what Jesus has done for us. We should also remember that God is not the source of our distress or trouble. That's Satan having a go at us. But God in his great plan and his great wisdom allows us to go through that so that we can really appreciate and understand just how much God loves us and how great it is. Next. In other words, although God's people experience the wrath of evil powers, we will never face God's wrath. And that's the good news, isn't it? He who created is not going to put his wrath on us. Next. Here's what happens after the Great Tribulation and comes back to the Lord's Prayer. A great angel will hurl Satan and the demon in the abyss, a symbol of death-like inactivity. He's going to be put into the pit. And Satan's condition in the abyss will be likened to being in prison. He will be unable to influence affairs elsewhere. He's stuck and he can't get out and meddle in the world. Maybe he's not in one of New South Wales prisons, but he will have no influence in what happens in this world. Next. And the millennium begins. The thousand-year reigns begin. God's kingdom will begin. It's a thousand-year reign. This is in the Bible. It talks about the new heaven and the new earth, which will bring great blessings to mankind. Revelations 5:9 and so on. And an unnumbered great crowd will come out of the great tribulation, surviving it to see the start of the millennium on earth. Our Father, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's where we're going. We're going to heaven, but we're also going to be on earth reigning. We're going to be the new part of the new earth, the new heaven. And I don't know how all that fits in and how it all meshes and goes on, but it doesn't matter. What matters is that we're going to be part of it. We're going to be the beginning of it. We're going to be on earth like it's never been before, with God in control. We've got a new body. We're not going to be in pain. How good is that? How good is that? What we have to remember is this. Next. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. All of this tribulation stuff and talk is there for encouragement. Great encouragement. And that's what we need to take out of all this. Not the horror, not the wrath, but the encouragement that Jesus is coming and coming quickly. And we must remember, and finally on the slide behind me that says, God is in control. Shall we pray? Father, may we fully understand by the signs and things that are going on around us, despite the stress, despite the trouble, despite the conflict, you are in control and you have called us and written our names down in the book of life. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. And if anyone wants to learn a little bit more about it or talk to me afterwards, please do. I'll be sitting down the front. So just be encouraged by the fact that God is in control.